everybody.
Good morning.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and we will be glad in it. Sometimes I like to say, I choose to rejoice.
Yes.
And be glad in it. You got to choose it sometimes, man.
Yeah.
Especially when you just feel like you got ran over by a Mack truck.
Yes.
The devil's mouthing off.
Yeah.
You just tell them that you know what, and then you choose to rejoice. Amen?
Yeah.
Praise God. What a good worship service this morning.
Amen.
I love it because this church has always been trained to enter right into the presence of the Lord because we know that we can't do anything without His presence.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. I mean, we can't do nothing without Him. Praise God. We need Him here. Amen. Sometimes.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
I'm just
going to
obey
the Lord
if you don't mind. I've got something I need to
release. Yeah, I don't have to. Oh, it's right there on the seat. Yeah, go ahead.
I
understand that.
I'm not trying to be disrespectful or anything, but I wanted to make sure that I obey the Lord because it's really strong in my heart. There's someone in this place here that is battling right now a financial issue. I mean, you know, we all have bills to pay. We all have bills to pay, and that's natural, the normal stuff that we can deal with. But there's something significant. Someone is like on the edge right now, and God is saying to come up here right now. I don't know who that is. I hope this is okay. But I want to minister to that one person. Who is that person that has a financial situation that needs to be addressed? Is that you, Tim? Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your
stretch your hand out.
Yes. In the name of Jesus.
Jesus.
You've brought this to my knowledge, Lord,
for
the whole purpose of bringing redemption. To interject the kingdom of God and the principles that lay there with you. The freedom that you have purchased by the blood of the Lamb. And we release right now in the name of Jesus, financial breakthrough.
Yes.
Financial breakthrough in the name of Jesus. Financial breakthrough in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you bring that which is needed. Father God, it is available to us already by the blood. In the name of Jesus. Obeying what you have seen, what I've seen in my spirit, I lay hands on my sister here, Lord, and I release the financial blessing.
Thank you, God.
I release a financial blessing on her life, Father. In the name of Jesus. Where there's no, this is what I'm hearing, where there's no covering, God is your covering. And I'm thanking you, Lord, for the covering of the Holy Ghost in Tammy's life, Lord. I'm thanking you for the covering, Lord, of the Holy Ghost in her life, Father God. Financial blessings coming from the left and from the right. Oh, from the east and the south, the north and the west, God is saying that, yes, I have everything in my hands. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that we have your word to stand on. And we stand on that word right now in Jesus' name. We don't stand on circumstances. We don't rely on the natural things that we see. We rely completely, Lord, on your word. And thank you for that redemption. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Yeah, go ahead. Just declare that over him.
Well, we declare the same thing over my brother-in-law. In the name of Jesus. Your word is good for one, it's good for all. So we thank you, Lord, that there is a breakthrough right now in the name of Jesus. That redemption comes in my brother's human right now, Lord. Things that were done wrong, Lord, if that's the case, then I thank you for a turnaround. I thank you for a turnaround in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Right now, Father God, let it happen as we speak, God. Thank you, Lord. I'm seeing in my spirit right now, I'm seeing that there are individuals that they're seeing what they have done. And they're acknowledging that it was all in the wrong.
Yeah.
Mm.
Praise God.
I'm seeing that in my spirit right now. Lord, I thank you for the conviction of the Holy Ghost. I thank you, Father God, for the conviction of the Holy Ghost. Thank you that you are the one that speaks to man. That nobody can do what you can do, Lord. When it comes to the matters of the heart, Father God, you are the greatest convincer, Lord, that we need to correct our actions and correct our behaviors, Father God. I thank you for the redemption even in that, God. that even in those situations where those individuals that are doing things wrong, Lord, that there's redemption for them, Lord.
Yes.
And that when they can turn their, and turn from their wicked way, Lord, and you will heal their land. And I thank you for healing the financial situation, my brother's life.
Yes, God.
In Jesus' name.
But Jesus, redemption with that. Jesus. We believe that.
Amen. Amen.
No, it's okay. Hey, everybody stand up and wants prayer for this. Just stand up where you're at right now.
I'll just release.
All right? It's about agreeing anyways. It's not about a master touch or anything. It's about getting an agreement with it right now. Go ahead.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
We thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
We thank you, Father, that in the kingdom there is resource.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, that in the kingdom there's plenty of God. I thank you that in the kingdom, Lord, there is more than enough, God. And every natural situation that we have in life, God,
yes.
You have delivered us, Lord. In the name of Jesus, let's have in mind, Father God. All those that are standing in this place, those that are not, Lord, I thank you that your word is for us. And your word declares that we have the kingdom available to us. And I release, in the name of Jesus, under the power of the Holy Ghost, I release right now a financial blessing over all of their lives, Lord. I release in the name of Jesus a way to prosper. I release to them, Father God, ways, Lord, that they can actually bring in resources to their lives, Lord. And I thank you that every need be met. Every need be met. In the name of Jesus. Thank you that there's finances coming from ways that we live and have an idea that they can come to us, Lord. And I thank you for favor in their life, God. In Jesus' name, I release that.
Lord, I just release that financial angels, Lord God, to visit every household in this body in the name of Jesus Christ. Angels of finances, God. I thank you, Lord, that you show us what to do with our finances, Lord God, concerning your kingdom and your power and your glory, Lord. And we thank you for that in the name of Jesus. Wisdom and knowledge. Wisdom and knowledge with our money, God, that you blessed us with. Wisdom and knowledge during this end time harvest, where to plant it, where to sow it, where to put it. In the name of Jesus, that's our heart, God. We line up with your word concerning that. And we receive that prophetic declaration and that prayer from our brother right now in the name of Jesus. We say, let it be so, let it be done in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Praise God. One more thing real quick. I just want to say this. At the end of our time earlier when we Karen came up, I sensed in my heart there was more, but I just went ahead and just...
Thank you, Lord.
Just, you know, let Karen go ahead and do the offering. But maybe that was the divine order. I don't know. Sometimes these things are hard to figure out. I told Jaime, I said, I knew there was more, and this was the more, what just happened.
Yes.
And I thank you for stepping up and being bold.
Yes.
Now listen to me. Here's the thing that I want to share with you. Some of us are sitting around here waiting for God to bless us, and He's waiting for us to receive it. He's waiting, you know, if you knew you had $1 million over here in the bank, and you're sitting in this church saying, thank you, Lord, for my $1 million. I receive it. You know, it's mine. I know it's mine. You got to go to the bank to get it. And so take hold of it. The enemy's going to resist you having it. He's going to resist you. But you're going to say no. You know, when God says the land is yours, go get it. When they obeyed God, they took the land. If they just stood back and said, look at the giants, look at the Lord, it's our land, it's our land. When are you going to give it to us? He's telling you, take hold of this today. Some of you are ashamed to be blessed financially. That's a lie from hell.
Take it all. God wants to bless.
As long as your motive is to use it for God's purposes, He wants you to be more blessed financially than you know He wants you to be blessed. But take hold of it. Believe you receive. You have to believe you've received it before you'll have it says in Mark 11. Take hold of it. It's mine. Everywhere I go, I expect favor. I expect blessing. I make sure I tip people that I don't want to tip. I bless them because everywhere I go, I'm running into the favor and the increase and the blessing of God. And God's getting ready to move on this earth in such a powerful, large way. He's got to have kingdom finance ministers to, he wants to use you to finance it. He's looking for people that have been faithful over little that he can make rulers over much. Praise God. As a matter of fact, where Jaime goes, he's still here. The Lord was showing me while you were given that word that you're a minister of finance. And that a lot of your training and things that God has been doing, it's all going to come together one day and make sense. And somehow, I don't understand it all, but somehow there's going to be a position that God's going to give you in the kingdom and in this natural world where you're going to oversee finances, large amounts of finances. Your decisions will affect large amounts of money in this earth, in the corporate world and in other ways. And God's going to use you to distribute those things into His projects, into His kingdom, into His way of doing things. It may not always go to a church or a missionary. It may go to another corporation, but it'll be somehow used for the purpose of God. Stretch your hands toward Jaime. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Yes. As he comes through that door of more, the door of blessing, the door of upgrade. Yes, we thank you for that, Lord. Hallelujah. We receive that word from the Lord. We receive the word that you gave through him to us. We take hold of it. It's time for people that don't have jobs to have them. It's time for people that don't have houses to have them. It's time for people who don't have the purpose of God in their life in this area to have them. People that need to have their people in here, you need to have your own business. God wants you to be able to make decisions listening to him, not having somebody on the earth telling you what to do every day for 8 or 10 hours. Nothing wrong with working for somebody, but God wants some of you to have your own business so that he can, you're not limited to a salary or an hourly wage. He can open it up. Open it up and bless. He says he'll bless the work of your hands. Glory to God. So we thank you for it, Lord. We receive it from heaven in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We receive it. I just kept hearing that word, golden handshake. Hallelujah. Golden handshake. Praise God. Whatever that means, I don't know. But doesn't that mean something like in the work world?
It's retirement.
Yeah, retirement.
Good going away.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
A blessing ahead of us.
Yeah. Right. Praise God. So you can kind of take that as, you know, when you retire, the word retire obviously is, you know, you don't have to work anymore. You can rest a little bit more and have a little more fun, be a little more, you know, doing whatever you want to do or whatever. So with biblical, I mean, I guess spiritually, I guess you can take that word is just enjoying your life and letting the blessing of the Lord bless you. Take a golden handshake from God. Why not? Amen. Yeah. Praise God. You know, Tim, I looked at you earlier on the stage today when I just happened to open my eyes and as soon as I looked at you, I heard the word double portion. So just take whatever that is. You can investigate that even more. Ask the Lord what that means. He'll show you. But I just heard that over you. Praise the Lord. Amen. Turn over to Joel chapter 2. This is great. I never get nervous before I come to church about what the Lord wants me to do because He always puts it together. He always has a plan and He always makes sure that we do it the way He wants it done and said the way He wants it said. Amen. So this is awesome. That word, Brother Jaime got up and shared and prayed. And then Dad, what he just shared and prayed. And this all goes right along with what the Lord was showing me this morning. As you turn into Joel chapter 2, just a lift of hands. I just want to see, and I'm not going to call you up here and have you say anything or nothing like that, but I just want to see. How many of you during praise and worship today, while we were worshiping the Lord, had some kind of a vision? Anybody? Like a revelation, a vision, you saw something about what the Lord wanted to do, or maybe He said something to you, you didn't want it. Anybody else? I know there's more, man. Lift them up high and hold them for just a second. Amen. That's great. About 5, 6, 7 of us. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, I had a vision myself during praise and worship. And when I had it, the Lord spoke to me and said, there's other people here and God showed them something. So I just wanted to identify who you were because I'm just going to get in agreement with you because that vision of the Lord, that revelation or whatever it was that He said or showed you will come to pass. And God wants you to, and here's the deal, it's actually, this is coming to me right now by the Spirit of God. I didn't know this until now, but he said that that's going to come sooner than you think.
Amen.
To be prepared for that, whatever that was.
Amen.
Amen. So you hold on to that in your heart. You stay open before the Lord concerning that vision, revelation, whatever it was that you had or saw or whatever. And let's do it. Now, I can't share what I saw yet, but man, it was pretty wild. I'll just leave it at that. And it was awesome. And it concerns all of us. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So I'll do that at some point. Praise God. Amen. So anyways, grab a hold of that and let the Lord use you in that. Joel chapter 2, look at verse 18. Joel chapter 2, verse 18. It says, "Then the Lord will be zealous for his land and pity his people. The Lord will answer and say to his people, behold, I will send you grain and new wine and oil, and you will be satisfied by them." Praise God. God wants us satisfied. God don't want us grumbling and complaining. He wants us filled with his milk and his honey. He wants us filled with his word. He wants us filled with his love. He wants us filled with every precious promise that Jesus provided on the old rugged cross.
Amen.
Amen. So he says, be satisfied. I will no longer make you a reproach among the nations, but I will remove far from you the northern army, and I will drive him away into a barren and desolate land, with his face toward the eastern sea, and his back toward the western sea. His stench will come up, and his foul odor will rise, because he has done monstrous things. Monstrous?
Yeah.
Things. Okay, hallelujah. Man, that's pretty, you chew on those scriptures for a while. It's kind of amazing. Verse 21. "Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done marvelous things. Do not be afraid, you beasts of the field, for the open pastures are springing up, and the tree bears its fruit. The fig tree and the vine yield their strength. Be glad then, you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the former rain faithfully, and he will cause the rain to come down for you, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month." What that's saying there is that you will get a year's rain in 1 month. Now, we've got some natural rain here the past few months. It's been epic for us. It's been great. It's filled our rivers, streams. It's given us snow. Praise God. I mean, the farmers are getting water. Hallelujah. I mean, there's water flowing. Praise God. There's things happening. Things are greener. Praise the Lord. The dust has settled down a little bit. Hallelujah. God has brought natural blessing to us. But he's also bringing spiritual blessings. I believe that this rain that we've had this season is a sign from God that we are entering into a freshness, a newness, a washing. Hallelujah. That we're entering into whatever water will do. What does water do? Water grows. You look at trees that are planted by rivers that are running all the time. They aren't dead. They're thriving. And whatever kind of tree they are, they're producing the fruit that has been planted there to produce. And I believe that that's what's happening in the body of Christ. Folks, I talk to a lot of people in the body of Christ about different things. And one of the main things I'm hearing people talk about is the church is praying. The church is praying. What brings God on the scene? Prayer. What causes God to manifest his glory, his power? It's a person or a nation or a people or a group that's seeking the face of God. Alright. Thought it was angels? Our little angels. But God is hearing the cry of our hearts, guys.
Yes,
we gotta get off what's going on in this crazy, goofed up, devil-filled world. and focused on what God's saying about the kingdom invading the world.
That's it.
That's where our eyes need to be. That's where our ears need to be. And check this out. Here's the biggest thing you'll hear today. That's where your tongue needs to be. What are you saying? What are you saying about it? What are you saying about your town? What are you saying about your neighborhood? What are you saying about your friends? What are you saying about your family? What are you saying about the body of Christ? What are you saying?
Saying. Amen.
You know, I got a pretty cool story that happened to me last Monday. I was out on my walk. I was walking, talking about what we're saying. Getting off on a little journey here, but I believe this will bless somebody. I was out on a walk, and I was just praying and spending time. I like to do that on my walks. I'm out there by myself, walking the river path out there. The river's flowing. It's beautiful. There's trees. There's squirrels running all over the place. Praise God. And I'm out there walking, and I'm praying, I went through leukemia back in 2008. Ever since then, there's just been some like a little bit of an anxiety and edginess in my life. And the last year, it's really picked up. And a lot of you have been hearing me talk about that and how this year's been pretty wild with that. But God's ripping that stuff out by the roots. Praise God. God's giving me revelation. Things are happening. Things are changing. Some of you, I talked to you about this a lot, so you know what's going on. But God's doing great things in my life. Hallelujah. He's just delivering me from that spirit of fear that's been trying to ruin my life forever. You know what I mean? But I'm getting delivered because I'm going into the next phase. I went through that door like Dad talked about today, and things are happening. Praise God. So I'm on my walk, and I'm walking, and it seems like ever since then, every time I go to the doctor, my blood pressure's up. And I don't have high blood pressure. My blood pressure's normal. I'm fine. I'm healthy, whatever. But when I go to the doctor, you know, some of you might identify with this today. You go to the doctor and it's like, oh, your blood pressure's high. And you're like, well, I know I don't have high blood pressure. It just happens when I come here. And they call that white coat syndrome. That's what they call that. You know, you go to the doctor, he wears a white coat. You know, you see it, your heart starts going, dip, 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 you know. That's what they call it. Okay, and I had no idea until, you know, five, six, 7 years ago or whatever, I heard it was called that. Because every time I'd go in there, the nurse would take my blood pressure and it'd be super high. And, well, you got high blood pressure. And I go, yeah, but I know I really don't. And they go, yeah, it's called white coat syndrome and blah, blah, blah. And also, we kind of laugh about it and all that kind of stuff. A doctor never says nothing about it when he sees it because I guess he just knows or whatever. So anyways, I'm on my walk and I'm walking. And this thought came to me and I said, Lord, when I go to my doctor in June, my yearly checkup, when I go to my doctor in June, I will not have white coat syndrome.
Amen.
I don't want that feeling. It's just a feeling. It's not even real.
Amen.
It's just it's a spirit of anxiety, fear. Amen. It's not me because I know there's nothing wrong. So Lord, I'm tired of that. I'm not going to mess with that anymore. And all of a sudden I heard the Lord say, no, you will have it. What? I'll have it. I just asked you to help me. And he said, what do you say every time you sit down with the nurse and she takes your blood pressure medicine? I say, oh, so we go, I have white coat syndrome. Yeah. I have.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have.
Yeah.
I have it.
Yeah, don't clean it.
It dawned on me. Some of you are going, well, duh, Pastor Mike, but you know, I could have told you that, you know. But it dawned on me, the revelation God showed me, is because you say you have it. Most people, what they're talking about is usually what they believe.
Yeah.
You can locate a lot of people just by listening to them talk, and you can figure out what they believe, where they're at, who they are. Because what people talk about is what they believe. It dawned on me. And I said, you know what, Lord, forgive me for that. I didn't even realize I was doing that. I just thought it was a joke and it's funny. But now that might not be, you know, you might be going, well, whatever. That's okay if this is for me. You know what I mean? God spoke to me about this. But I guarantee you what you're declaring over your life, you're going to have, good or bad. Sometimes our tongue will slip and we'll say something, you know, whatever. We understand that we're humans, we have emotion, things happen. But listen, just listen to your spirit, because you know if you're wrong, and if you're wrong, be quick to repent about that.
Yeah.
Ask the Lord to forgive you. And He will. Keep your heart right. Keep in love with people. Keep your mouth right. Keep your tongue right. Don't let it be a cursing. Let it be a blessing, praise God.
Right.
And that's something we work on. Amen. We have to. None of us are perfect.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
But He said it's because you say you have. Don't say you have. Say you have the Lord. Say you have blessings. Say you have healing. Say you have all this. Say what the Word says. Line your tongue up with the Word of God. Praise God.
Amen.
And He'll bless you. Amen. But you have what you say. Death and life in the power of tongue. Proverbs 18:21. We know that. Amen. Okay, so that's just a good little nugget. Won't charge you for that. Praise God. Just be blessed by that. Amen.
Amen.
So it says here, the former latter rain. Verse 24. The threshing floor shall be full of wheat.
Hallelujah.
Or can you say harvest? Hallelujah.
Yes.
Yes. And the vats shall overflow with new wine.
Yes.
And oil. Praise God. Let's just say it this way. The vats will overflow with joy, and the vats will overflow with healing anointing. Praise
Amen.
God.
Amen.
We're heading into a revival. We're heading into a thing. We're already into it. Praise God. It's just gaining momentum as we listen to the Spirit of the Lord and obey Him and do what He's called us to do as individuals, but also as the body of Christ flowing together. Many members, but we're many members, and we have the call of God in our life. Amen. So as we're flowing together, as we're loving together, as we're keeping our eyes on the kingdom, as we're keeping our eyes on what God is saying to us individually, but also what God is saying to the whole body of Christ, as we get in that river with the body of Christ, praise God, we're going to start to see the healing oil flow. We're going to start seeing the harvest come in. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God. God has made it very plain that in the last days He's going to pour out His Spirit on all flesh. God has made it very, we'll get to that in a minute. God has made it very plain in the last days that He's coming back for a glorious church. He's not coming back for a church that's hiding in the corner cowering over the enemy, guys.
Yeah.
That's not us.
Yeah.
We're victorious.
Amen.
We are seated together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. The Father took Jesus up into heaven, sat Him at the right hand of the Father, sat Him at the right hand of Himself, praise God. And then it says in Ephesians chapter 1 that we were brought up far above principalities and all the demonic forces of the earth. And it says that He has brought us above every name that's named. And He says that we are seated together in Christ Jesus. See yourself in Christ. See yourself bold. See yourself full of faith. See yourself full of joy. See yourself full of harvest, praise God. See yourself full of the anointing of the glory of the risen Son of Jesus Christ. That's really who you are, guys. The devil hates you. He wants to see you broke, busted, and disgusted. He wants to see you in fear, Clarence. He wants to see you give up. He wants to see you run from the fight instead of run to the fight. You can't do it on your own strength. You've got to rely totally on Father. Believe me, I know a lot of you can even share way more experience than I have by trying to do it on your own, and it never works. But when you do it, when you rely on the Father. Listen, I was a guy that I didn't like to fight. It depended on the situation. But I was a guy that didn't really, I didn't go around looking for problems or looking to fight. I was a nice guy. I had a lot of friends. I had a lot of friends of different races, different colors, different backgrounds. I had a friend, I just had a lot of friends. But I was one that I will not quit. I won't quit.
Yeah.
I wouldn't quit. I just had that mentality. I'm not going to quit.
Amen.
True.
You got to know that the devil wants you to quit.
That's right.
He tries to get you on, focused on your brother Blab and sister Bucket Mouth and this guy over here, this person over here, and what they think, and who said this, and what this is going on, and this is the circumstance. He wants to get us all wrapped around all that mess, all that distraction.
Yeah. Yes.
And sometimes, I'll just be honest with you, we get our eyes off onto that sometimes, and we give into that, and we get riled up for a day or two or three or four or five.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or even more, maybe. I don't know. But what I've been asking the Lord, because I've been really serious about this in my life, because I don't want to get distracted on the call. I don't want to get distracted from where God wants me to go. Because I know that there are people that He has for me that He wants me to bless and help. Just like He does you.
Amen.
And so the enemy tries to get us all distracted on what's going on, tries to get us in some verbal argument, tries to get us to think things that are wrong, tries to get us into all this kind of stuff to keep us distracted from what the Word of God is saying about you, from what the calling of God is on your life. And see, let me say something. I don't care how long you've been a Christian. You might have only been a Christian for one day, for 25 years, for 90 years, whatever. I don't know. But how long you've been a Christian, God wants to use you now. He wants you to fulfill what He's called you to fulfill now. He wants you to run the race now. He doesn't want you to be distracted and get off course. He wants you to stay right in your lane and do and run and do what God has called you to do. Praise God. But He tries to get you off course by distracting you. Listen, let me say something to you guys. And I know we hear a lot of this said, but this is the truth, man. Paul said, you know, you're going to be persecuted. You know, you're going to have stones thrown at you. You know, you're going to have words thrown at you. You're going to have people that don't like you. You're going to have people that you've been friends with for 24 years hate you for no reason.
Yeah.
I'm going through that right now. Personally. And there's no reason for it. But I can't speak for the person's heart. I can't speak for them. But the devil will use that to try to draw me into strife. Because it's very easy. Especially when you're around this person a few times a week. Very easy. He wants you. He wants to entice you. He's dangling that carrot. Like, go ahead, just take it, Mike. Get the flesh. Yeah. Say something you shouldn't say. Right. Act the way you shouldn't act. Right. Right. You know how I diffuse it? Honestly? And I've talked to Dad about this, and I've showed some emotions toward Dad concerning this situation I'm talking about. But you know how the Lord has shown me to diffuse it? Walk when I know I'm going to have to be around or walk by or be a part of this person for a while. This is me. Okay, I don't know how God wants to use you to do it. You know how I do it? I start praying in tongues.
Yeah,
man.
Got it.
Show me how I can do it. Yeah. I don't go out there, I'm not so. No. I just, right before I get to the place I know I got to get to, when I know it's going to be there, when that is, the opposition is going to meet me, when that face is going to be there, when those thoughts are going to start coming, I ought to that, blunt, and you I get over the spirit as fast as possible, guys. I'm just being honest with you. I don't know how else to do it, man. Friends of God comes, the love of God comes. Come on, man. Am I the only one that has to deal with this kind of stuff? Nobody else ever battles. You know, nobody else ever has that little, you know, little devil, little angel sitting there, you know, and just, you know. Diffuse it by the Spirit. Same thing with the devil. When he mouths off at you, diffuse him with the word of the Lord. Folks, let me tell you something. It's kind of like, you know, if you're an artist and you practice drawing, and as you practice, you get better and better. You have a gift for it. If you're an athlete, the more you practice that sport, you know, the more you work at it, the more you'll get better and better at it. Well, it's the same thing with serving the Lord. The more you learn how to condemn the enemy and tell him to shut up and leave you alone, the stronger you get at it, the easier it gets. I'm just being honest with you. And the more, instead of it just blindsiding you, knocking you down for a few hours, within minutes, you're free and you're moving on, and he's shut up and he's left you alone. You've got to exercise the word of the Lord. Every time there's opposition, you've got to know the ammo that you have, the scripture that God wants you to use, and you've got to speak and declare it, and the enemy will shut up and he'll leave you alone.
Amen.
That's a word for people in this place today, guys. I'm telling you by experience that if you'll use the word of the Lord, I'm telling you, by in the name of Jesus Christ, I'm telling you that your faith will grow. Your anointing will grow. Your power will grow. The Bible says that we are to condemn the enemy.
That's right.
With our mouth.
Amen.
Isaiah 54.
Yes.
We are to condemn the enemy.
Yes.
It talks about how God created the blacksmith. He created all that. But when he comes after us, God says, I've given you power, Bridget, Glenn, Clarence. I've given you power to condemn the enemy.
Yes.
See, messing with your kids, devil, take your hands off. My children will fulfill the will of God, the purpose that God has for their lives. But guys, we are, listen, I'm not looking at a bunch of wimps this morning. I'm looking at a bunch of people with the armor of God standing in the glory of the Lord. No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every lying tongue that rises against you, guys, will be condemned. You condemn them. I got the anointing of God. I'm not ready to throw the pulpit through the wall. That's how strong I feel. I'm juiced right now in the glory. Hallelujah. There's no devil in here. I guarantee you this morning. He's been bound and he's gone. We got a bunch of faith fanatics in here this morning. People that love Jesus. Amen. Guys, we have been made victorious. We are royalty in the eyes of God. We are His heirs. We have not been left orphaned, the Bible says. That we've been adopted in the beloved. Guys, see yourself that way. See yourself as His child. He is not going to throw His children into the lion's den. He is not going to throw His children into the fire.
Amen.
When you're following Him, you've given your life to Him. He knows where you're at spiritually. He knows how to talk to you. But the thing is a lot of folks don't ask Him anything.
Amen.
Ask Him for help. Ask Him to show you. Ask Him to dissect you. Because there's things sometimes that are just hidden that you don't even know.
That's right.
Now, I'm not saying this for you to get all worked up and get in fear and oh no and all this. Get before the Lord. Just stay open to Him. All you got to do is have your heart open to Him. And He'll show you where the enemy is causing chaos, guys.
Yeah.
He'll show you.
That's right.
And He'll show you how to defuse it. And He'll show you how to get delivered from it. And He'll show you how to have full victory over it.
Hallelujah.
Guys, I'm going to tell you just that little piece of nugget of revelation to me that I got last Monday walking down the pathway. Has changed my life.
Yes, yes, yes.
I don't even know. Some of you might not understand that, but it really has.
Amen.
He showed me what I'm saying. He showed me how to defuse it. Don't say it.
Amen. Amen. Yep.
It won't happen. Well, I don't believe that stuff, and you must not believe in salvation either. Because that's how you get saved, by faith. You use your mouth.
Amen. That's good.
I don't believe that blab it, grab it stuff. And you don't believe in salvation. Because you got to use your mouth, confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and shall be saved. Someone's going to believe something.
Amen.
Right. Woo, that's pretty good right there. And you know where I heard that from? I'll be honest with you, I heard from Brother Kenneth Hagin.
Amen.
Amen. But that's true. I take no credit for that saying right there. That was from him. I heard it. And it blessed me. Now, it says here, verse 25, so I'll restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust. Jeez. That's a crazy locust, man. I want no part of that. But God says, I'll restore to the years that those things have ate. Guys, don't worry about your past. It's under the blood. If you give your life to Jesus Christ, you repent of your sins, it's gone. The Bible proves it. It says it. You can't find it anywhere. It's in the sea of forgetfulness. It's gone. There's no God. Don't remember it. The blood of Jesus Christ is on the mercy seat right now, crying out for us. Thank God for the blood of mercy. Thank God for grace. Thank God for favor. Hallelujah. Amen?
Amen?
So your past is gone. All that stuff the devil tricked you in, had you held bondage in, convinced you that you were something that you're really not or whatever, all that junk that took place, God says it's gone. And God says a good thing about that. He says He's going to restore to you where the enemy has stolen.
Amen.
Where the enemy has confused, God's going to bring back restoration. We have a restoring God. A God full of mercy, grace, a God full of love, and a God full of restoration to you guys.
Yeah.
And to anyone that will believe it and receive it. Praise the Lord. Well, how do I qualify for that? Believe it?
Yeah.
And then act upon what God has shown you concerning those situations or circumstances. Act upon them. Do what the Word says. So it says here, in verse 26, you shall eat in plenty and be satisfied. Now this goes along with this prophetic declaration that we received earlier concerning finances. And you shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrously with you. And my people shall never be put to shame. Then you shall know that I am in the midst of Israel. I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. My people shall never be put to shame. And it shall come to pass, verse 28, afterward, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. You know, that trips me out because I must be an old man because I'm having a lot of dreams lately. Am I old now, God? Because I'm having dreams. Is this the scripture apply to me now? I don't know. Season. Praise God. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. Verse 29. And also on my men servants, and on my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, and blood and fire and pillar of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood, before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord.
Amen.
This scripture used to scare the hell out of me sometimes. And I mean that in a good way. I'm not cussing. Should I tell her a little story or should I just let it go by?
Tell it.
One time.
Don't tell.
One time. One time, me and Bonner saw the orange, bloody-looking moon, and it scared the fire out of us. We started throwing stuff out the car window. I'll just leave it at that. But anyways, yeah, because it was. We saw that moon look bloody. We thought, oh God, he's coming back. Pastor's kids knew the word of the Lord. They weren't doing the word of the Lord, but they knew it. We finally got straightened out. Praise God. So every time I read this verse, I just laugh. And it shall come to pass, hallelujah, that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. For in Mount Zion, or did you say the church, guys? And in Jerusalem there shall be deliverance. As the Lord has said, among the remnant whom the Lord calls. Say, I'm called.
I'm called.
For greatness.
Greatness.
I'm called. To walk.
In the glory.
And the anointing. And the plan.
And the purpose.
That God has created. Me to walk in.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It shall be done. What does the word amen mean? It means so. It's done. We're walking in a time that this world has never been walked in.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know. I just, it seems like there's so much all the time that God is doing. Sometimes it just seems like there's just so much. It's like, wow. You know? It's like you can't retain everything you hear and all this stuff. It's like, man, it's so good. It just blesses you. But the good thing about God is He will plant in you what you need to remember when this time goes on.
Yeah.
And the Lord even says it. He says, he'll bring back to remembrance those things he's spoken to you guys.
Yeah.
So we don't have to try to remember everything. But what he's sown into your life, we'll remember, and he'll bring that back up when you need to remember it. Praise God.
Yeah.
But we are walking in a time and a realm, guys, where it is so... Listen, I challenge you to put your harvest glasses on.
Yeah.
Amen.
Lots of walking around.
That's good.
That's good.
Right.
Because there are a lot of people. They might not show it on the outside, or you might not see it on the outside, but they are hungry for peace. They are hungry for love. They are hungry for joy. They're hungry for someone to put their anointed hand that they don't even know on their back and say, "You'll be fine, man. The Lord's got a plan for you. He loves you. And he wants to help you." They might not even understand that. But those anointed words of love out of your mouth is Jesus speaking to them.
That's right.
Don't sell yourself short, guys.
Don't sell.
See, I know this. This is how the devil works. Well, you only go to church a few times a year, so you know you don't have no power. Or you used to do this, or you used to be this way, or you did this yesterday, or you did this morning, so that nullifies the word of God in your life. No, it does not. I've never read that scripture anywhere. And here's another fun fact for us. What is the devil? He's a liar. He's an accuser of the brother, the Bible says. So everything he says to you is an accusation. To get you into condemnation, to get you to back off, like I was talking about earlier, back off. The plan that God has for your life. To back off from you reaching out and touching someone.
Yeah.
And watching healing take place, watching salvation take place, watching joy, love, peace take place. Yeah. He wants you to back off from being like Jesus. That's his main mission. You don't worry too much about people that aren't following Christ. He's got them already. Some folks will cut those chains and they'll get saved. They'll come into the harvest. I believe we're going to see a lot of people.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to see way more people in heaven than we are now. I guarantee that.
Amen.
Some people choose. That's just a fact. Okay. But I'm talking about harvest right now. Put your harvest glasses on. Because they're out there.
Yeah.
And what is so awesome is the least likely person that you think won't receive from you will. That's another deal the devil tries to do. He tries to put some kind of smoke screen in front of you, thinking that, no, there's no way you can even identify with that person. If God takes you to a person, I don't care if they're the meanest person on the face of the earth. If God takes you to them, God's going to touch them. That's God. He knows what he's doing. He knows where to put you, where to plant you, where to have you go tomorrow. He knows what he has for you. So put those glasses on. Walk around and just be open to the Holy Spirit. If you've got to remind yourself daily, Holy Spirit, I'm open to you today. Just use me today. I know there's folks that need you, Father. Man, I'm telling you, You'll start having encounters with people that you never thought you would have encounters with.
Yeah.
You'll start finding yourself loving people that you never thought you could have a love for.
Amen.
When you stay open to the Holy Spirit concerning harvest.
Yeah.
Amen.
You'll find yourself going out of your way to bless someone.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
You'll have the desire and the passion to go out of your way and to do something for somebody that will bless them. That's the kind of heart I want. That's what I'm shooting for. I want the softest heart I can have. And going through the process of wanting the softest heart you can have for people, sometimes it's a pretty rough process. Because God starts showing you things in your life that have hindered you from that, and he wants those things out of you to move on into that.
That's right.
And it's tough sometimes. And it's rough sometimes. And sometimes you bang your head against the wall. Sometimes you fall and skin your knee. Sometimes it's rough because God starts to reveal to you things in our lives that he wants us delivered from.
Yeah.
But you know what? Guys, it's worth it.
It sure is.
It's worth it, guys.
Amen.
I heard the Lord speak to me this, and now I'm just going to share this. And this doesn't go against the Word of God. I heard the Lord say this to me one time. And it does say in the Word that we're being persecuted and stuff like that, but I choose not to get focused on that.
Amen.
Okay, because that's going to happen. It's going to come. I choose to focus on where God's taking them on,
yes.
where God's putting them on,
yes.
what God's doing through them.
Yes.
I choose to focus on that. I heard the Lord speak to me here about a year ago in prayer, and He said, Mike, you're not being persecuted, you're being propelled. He's moving the body forward. He's pushing us forward into things. So get you talking to me. Get your eyes off the persecution and get your eyes on where I'm propelling you, where I'm taking you. Guys, get your eyes off what's going on around you and get your eyes on where God's taking you. What he has for you this afternoon? What he has for you tonight? What he has for you tomorrow? What he has for you this week? Who can you bless? Who can you love?
Yes.
Who can you minister to?
Yes.
Who can you just be a part of
yes.
that needs someone to be a part of their life?
Amen.
Yes.
That's it.
Yes. See, God always wants me, it seems like God always has me be transparent. About my own life. And that's fine.
Yeah.
I don't care. Fine. Because I'm human. But one of the things I'm learning how to do right now is to not overreact about everything.
Yeah.
You know, some things just get your goat, you know?
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, you're just kind of kicking back, watching TV, and all of a sudden something happens, you're like, wow, 0 to 100, like a millisecond, you know?
Amen.
That's one thing I'm having the Lord help me on. Instead of reacting, stopping for a second and seeing what it's about first.
Amen.
And then make a judgment on it. Or then make a decision on it.
Yeah.
Or then react how I need to react. How I shouldn't have. See, life sometimes isn't a lot of fun.
It's not fair either.
Whoever said that, I agree. It's true. But what my mom would always say is, life isn't fair, but God always is.
Amen.
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 Sometimes we get confronted by the enemy.
Yeah.
And he wants us to back up.
Yeah.
He wants us to live in fear. And he wants us to take the thought. And then he wants us to say the thought.
That's right.
That's why the word says, take no thought, say.
Amen.
Don't give life to it.
Amen.
Don't give life to it. You want your tree to die in your front yard? Stop watering it.
Yeah.
Right? That's not rocket science, but that's the truth. That's nature. That's how it works.
Amen.
It's the same thing with your mouth. You want to start giving life to something that needs life? Start speaking to it. Start watering with the word. I feel like I'm jumping around a little bit today, but this is something you'll be
good,
hearing.
Good.
This is the Holy Spirit, and I'm thankful for it. But see, he wants us to stay. He wants us to accept things that have been planted in our lives as a child, or things that we've learned over the years that weren't correct, and he wants us to stay in that cage and live that way. The devil does not want us to be free from that. So when he sees, now here's a good word here, when he sees that you're pursuing the Father, and when he sees that you're making headway, and when he sees that you're growing in the things of God, what does the devil do? He turns up the heat because he has one last try to keep you bound. So that's why some of you are experiencing that torment, that fire, that whatever is going on in your life, that's why you're experiencing it harder than ever before, because you made a commitment to follow Jesus Christ. And I'm not saying this to scare you. Let me say it this way. You made a decision to go all the way in. You're not a toe swimmer. You're a swimmer. You're not a, I want to test the water before I go in deal. I never did that, dude, because if I did that, I probably wouldn't get in because it'd be cold. I just went for it. Yeah! Jump in. And that's how you get used to it, real fast.
Amen.
That's what you got to do. says, oh no, and he panics and he freaks and he acts like an idiot. And he comes after you like an idiot because he comes after you and God just says, you're just going to have to restore everything you're trying to mess with them with. You want to mess with my kids? God says, you want to mess with my kids? Then I'm just going to promote them even more. I'm going to bless them even more. I'm going to protect them even more. I'm going to give them more influence. I'm going to give them more favor. I'm going to give them more finances. I'm going to give them more revelation. I'm going to give them more knowledge of my word and my kingdom. So that way they will just destroy the kingdom of darkness as they grow on in this life.
Amen.
That's what God does.
Thank you, Lord.
He knows the enemy's defeated. He was defeated when Jesus said, it is finished. Bam. The curtain was torn, freaked everybody out, opened up that veil, was torn, so we can go before the Father, hallelujah, and stand as righteousness in His sight. We are kingdom people, guys.
Amen.
We are protected, we are blessed, we are honored by God as we honor God, praise God, and He will do whatever He has to do to protect His children.
Amen.
Just like you would yours. That's the kind of God we serve.
Amen.
It's not about being good and how many scriptures I know and all that. All that's good. It's about a heart thing. It's about following Him, being sincere before Him, giving your life to Him, and saying, God, help me grow. Because I'm immature. In areas. That's what it's about. And as you grow, you get more experience. He gives you more. He blesses you with more. He'll trust you with more.
Yeah,
as you grow with Him, praise God, you'll start seeing fruit. He'll start leading you to people. He'll help you cast out devils. He'll help you raise the dead. He'll help you lay hands on the sick. He'll move through you in all these areas like He said you could move in. That's God.
That's God.
And I know none of us have hit the mark yet.
Amen.
None of us are perfect. None of us get everything right. But one thing we do get right is we serve the living God.
Amen.
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 Help us grow.
Amen.
And back when I was smoking cigarettes, a long time back. Huh? With who? Oh, you. Every once in a while. The bloody moon thing. No, I'm not talking about that. I remember one time. I'm going to share this story because, listen, do I believe in smoking? If you smoke cigarettes, you smoke cigarettes. Fine, whatever. That's up to you. It's going to make you smell like hell, but you smoke cigarettes. You know? Which, whatever. But I remember one time I didn't have any cigarettes, and I went down to this guy's house a couple streets down. This was back in, I don't know, probably 1998 or something like that. I quit smoking in December 29th, 1999. God yelled at me and said, quit! Didn't you cry, baby? Because I was crying about wanting to quit. And He spoke to me and said, if you want to quit, quit, you big cry, baby. That's what He said. Please, God, take this from me. And I was doing one of those deals. That's how He spoke to me. And I just did it. Amen. So, He helped me. So I walked down to this guy's house, and I kind of met this guy. I didn't know him very long. I lived there down the street from him. I'd known him a couple months, and I went down there, and I knew he smoked, and I didn't have any cigarettes. So I went down there, and I said, hey, man, and he was down in his garage. And, what's going on? Then we started talking. I bummed a cigarette off him. I'm sitting there smoking a cigarette, and all of a sudden, the anointing of God came on me. To witness this guy.
Yeah.
I'm being honest. And I'm sitting in this, and I'm smoking the Marlboro. You know, I'm sitting there. You know, man, God will help you in that situation. You know? I'm sitting there. And I love the Lord. I was born again. I was serving the Lord. And I'm sitting there, and the door just opened wide, man. And I'm just ministering to this guy. And by the time I got to smoking that cigarette, I was praying salvation with the guy, man. And he gave his life to Christ.
Amen.
Yeah. Now, I'm not condoning go out and next time you go witness to smoke. That's not the key. That's not the way to do it. That's not the secret, you know, key to it or whatever. It's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, see, immediately when I left that place, immediately, I remember it just like it was yesterday. Immediately the devil said that guy didn't really get saved because you were smoking in front of him. How can you be a Christian? How can you really love God and you're doing that in front of this guy? And he knows you're a pastor or you're a youth leader and he knows that. How can you do that? And I, first for a second there, I thought, yeah, I did that. And then you start beating yourself up. But then the Lord started talking to me the next day about that. Because I saw the guy again, and I went over and I was talking to him. He sat in the front yard, and I was talking to him a little bit before I was leaving to do what I needed to do. And he said, man, I just feel like my life's changed. I just feel at peace. You know, I slept good. And all, he was sharing all this kind of stuff. The Lord started talking to me about, see, it's what, who's, it's me in you. It's the Word.
Yeah.
It's what it is.
Yeah.
Now, you need to stop doing that because you're killing yourself. And you know that. When you're smoking, you know you're hurting yourself.
Yeah.
You know it. No one has to tell you that. You don't have to go to the doctor to find that out. You know you are. So you know it. So eventually I quit and all that kind of stuff. And God helped me do that and all that. I got rid of that nicotine habit and stuff. But see, that's what the devil will try to do to you guys.
Right.
When you blow it and you make a mistake, what does he do?
Yeah.
He tries to condemn you.
Yeah.
I've learned now that when I blow it and make a mistake and he tries to condemn me, I repent immediately and I go after God harder than ever before.
Amen.
Because I know that I'm free.
Right.
Use it as a springboard. That's a good thing there right here, Dad. Use that as a springboard. Grow from that. Grow from that. When the devil tries to condemn, no devil, shut up, you're a liar. God knows my heart. I've repented. I've already done this. And you know what? It isn't even any of his business if you repent or not. You're not, he's not your father. It is none of the devil's business what God has for you. It is none of the devil's business what God has shown you or told you. You tell them to shut it.
They do.
The devil will come and he will find no open door in my life. My flesh wants to sin. My flesh wants to kill itself. My flesh wants to go a whole other direction than the way God has for me. But I know too much in my spirit to go that direction, and I'm going the direction God has for me. And you might have to get up for the next month and tell yourself, devil, shut up, I'm not going your direction. I'm a child of God. You turn your back on him and you go where the Father wants you to go.
Exactly right.
Amen.
Because sometimes he waits for you to wake up. So he can lie. He is a defeated foe.
Amen.
He's defeated by the blood. Woo! Glory. You gotta take this message this morning and just smash him with it.
Amen.
And go out and do what God's called you to do.
Amen.
That's how you smash him.
Amen.
I'm gonna close. It's 11:29. You guys are used to 12, but Dad, you're used to 12. We're good. You're fired! Real quick, I want to share this with you that I got on Tuesday morning at prayer. This goes right along with what the Lord had me minister today. We're in prayer here on Tuesday morning. We have corporate prayer every morning on Tuesday mornings at 10. If you want to come, you're welcome to. We've been growing, man. We had 25 people.
Yeah.
We've been growing. I mean, that prayer community has been growing. It's getting more stronger and stronger. It's been awesome. But the Lord spoke these three words to me on Tuesday morning prayer, and I shared it with the prayer group that's here Tuesday, but I want to share it with you because I think you need to grab a hold of this. If you want to write it down, you can. He shared these three words with me during prayer, and he said, Mike, it's time for the body of Christ to, number one, rule, to, number two, reign, and to, number three, dominate.
Yeah.
Rule, reign, and dominate. The word rule means one of a set of explicit or understood regulations or principles governing conduct within a particular activity or sphere. It's time for the body of Christ to rule in the sphere that God has given you. The word reign means hold royal office, rule as king or queen. The Bible says we're kings and priests unto our God. We are to rule as king. Ladies, you're to rule as a queen in the army of God. See yourself as that. See yourself ruling, see yourself reigning through the blood of Jesus Christ, because we are. Now, we can get in the Word and we can dissect each of these three words and we can pull Scripture out. Okay, I don't have time to do that today, but you can. You can get in there and find word, you rule, why you rule, and how you rule, and you can get in there and find why you reign and how you reign in the body. And the last word, dominate. The word dominate means have a commanding influence on or to exercise control over.
Yes.
Have a commanding influence on and or exercise control over. Guys, we dominate the enemy. The enemy doesn't dominate us.
Right. Amen.
See, a lot of people that play sports, you kind of have an understanding of this kind of stuff. Because when I went out to play sports, I didn't want to go out to patty cake and slap each other on the butt. And,
yeah.
I went out to dominate.
Yeah.
And if I couldn't beat you, then I would just fight you to get thrown out of the game. You know what I mean? That's just, I did not want to lose. And there was times where I did lose and I got the poop beat out of me. But guys, we win in the kingdom. We dominate in the kingdom. We need to exercise our authority through the blood of Jesus Christ over the sphere that God has given us, over whatever rule God has caused us to rule in, and we need to reign in that, and we need to exercise our authority by the Word of God over whatever it is God wants you to exercise your authority. And He wants you to dominate in that situation. And when you dominate in it, the love of Jesus comes forth and harvest comes in. And He gave me a vision that morning after He spoke those words to me. I was laying right over there on the chair. I saw this vision and I saw a whirlwind of body parts. And my first thought was, thank you, Lord. You're bringing body creative miracles. You're going to heal people. And He said, no, that's not what it is. He's going to do that, but He said, that's not what this is you're seeing. I said, what is it? And He said this. He said, I'm giving increase to the body of Christ, the parts and the part that they have to play here on earth right now at this time.
Amen.
He's increasing your part in the body.
Amen.
He's increasing your part not only in the body, but so you can have influence outside the body to bring in the loss. I saw a whirlwind of body parts, and they were parts. God was increasing the body of Christ, increasing individuals, increasing you, so that you, increasing your part, your gift, whatever it is He has to play, He's putting increase on it for you to go out and do it in a greater, grander, more power, more glory, is style.
Amen.
You can receive that or you don't have to. It's up to you, but I saw that. And I know it's for the body.
Yes.
It's for us.
Yes.
So you start looking at what your part is, and you start looking at increase in your part. I don't care if you're a baby Christian, if you're just starting to serve the Lord right now. I don't care if you've been serving the Lord for 45 years. Your part needs to be played. If you don't know how to do it, ask God. He knows how to do it, and He'll tell you, and He'll show you.
Yeah.
See, you don't have to know every scripture in the Bible, because guess what? I know. There's a lot of scriptures I know. I don't even know where they're at in the Bible. I just know them.
Yeah.
But know the Word.
Yeah.
I have fun today. Yeah. Had the preach come on me a couple times. That's a good thing. That feels fun. That David anointing comes on you sometimes, man. Or you just rip head off the bear, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Guys, hoo-hoo. We've got so much power in us. God's moving in this church, guys. God's moving in this ministry. I'm hearing testimony after testimony. People getting healed. Things getting happened. There's a lady that's in this place this morning that she was suffering pain for years in a certain situation in her body, and the Lord Jesus Christ touched her and healed her. She hasn't had pain for weeks.
Amen. Glory to God.
Amen. I'm not going to tell story after story. Things are happening. Not a lot of you guys hear all this, because sometimes people will come talk to us and share with us, but there's a lot of things going on in this body. And what God's doing is He's equipping us and getting us ready for the for the harvest, because we're a hospital.
Yeah.
People are going to come, and you're going to get to play your part. You're going to get to lay hands on people. You're going to get to bring deliverance. You're going to get to bless people. That's why we're here, guys. And if this is your church, you're connected with this. This is your body. This is your local church. This is where God's brought you. Then you have that same anointing on you to do it here and out there.
Yeah.
We're doing it.